One will be drawing and the other will be letting you guys ask questions, but also talking about the different techniques they are using while they are creating this work for you. And you'll see they've already very good started. It's awesome. Okay. Paige, did you have anything you wanted to say about Hi-Rez at all?
Yes, so thank you to everyone for coming. Thank you to SCAD for hosting us. Molly, Blaine, thank you for having us out here. And thank you to Brian and Marcus for volunteering their time to come and do this awesome work, which looks like it's already looking pretty amazing. But so Hi-Rez Studios, we're a local game developer. We publish our own games. We've made Global Agenda, Tribes, and Smite, our most popular game. Smite's actually about to come out on Xbox One. So if you ever want to play a MOBA on a next-generation console, you can sign up for the beta by going to smitegame.com, checking it out. We have all sorts of fun events all the time on the weekends and sales and cool things. So just follow us on Twitter at smitegame and on Facebook at smitethegame and come check us out.
And we'll be passing codes out at the end of this. So when you go out the door, make sure Justin has a bunch from Hi-Rez for skins so that you guys can get skins in the game. And then I'm
going to
pass the
phone
to you guys.
Yeah. Hey, guys. Nice to meet you all. Welcome to our Speaking 101. We are concept artists from Smite. I am Marcus Luck. This is Brian Wells. Shall we get started?
Yeah. Hey, Gabe.
Hi.
How's it going, Gabe?
Gabe is also from Hi-Rez.
Yes. Do you have anything to say before we start?
Something smart sounding. To know what you do not know is the beginning of wisdom.
So Brian will start painting a character for us, and I'll be answering your questions. So if you guys have anything to ask, just feel free to ask me.
All right.
So here we go. Let's begin.
Don't want that one.
Do you know what you're making?
Nope.
Or is it just...
Brian wants to win for today.
Yeah, we're just going to have some fun here and kind of figure out what we're doing kind of as it goes.
Yeah. Tell us more about your thought process as your logic shapes down.
So really right now, I'm just trying to find some kind of interesting silhouette that will sort of guide us through. I'm thinking something kind of monstrous because that's just kind of the mood that I'm in tonight.
Why don't we take a... Do you want to take a crowd vote?
A crowd vote?
Yes.
Okay, what are we going to get them to vote on?
All right, we're going to do a feature then. Someone said it's going to be awesome.
Yeah. So, let's get started here.
So right now, I guess he's just paying attention to silhouette. He wants to have a clear read,
mm-hmm.
Just like this, without detail.
Yeah. So getting the silhouette ready, that's sort of the first step I'd normally go for when I'm actually doing a speed painting for a character, which is typically my bailiwick since I am a character concept artist.
So what have you designed for Hi-Rez?
What have I designed for Hi-Rez? I have designed a lot of gods, a lot of skins. I started on with Neith and Apollo, then through Hunbats, and then a long road from there, Kabrakan, Sylvanas.
So he's designed a lot of gods.
It's a long list.
Yeah. And your latest one was just released.
Medusa. I remember her, yes. I do those, I do a lot of skins, and then occasionally some other support. I've worked on the environment end for the new Conquest map, some original iterations of the arena map. I do stuff. I do a lot of stuff.
That's a lot of stuff.
Yeah. So why don't you tell them what you do?
I'm also a concept artist. I am currently with the UI team at Hi-Rez, making icons and crests. Before I joined Hi-Rez, I used to be a freelance concept artist, working on League of Legends, World of Warcraft. Maybe you guys have heard of that. But now I work on Smite.
No, what is that?
I have no idea, man.
Well, maybe it'll get big someday.
Yeah, someday. Yeah. Always hoping.
Be awesome to hear your choice of pressure brush choices and pressure choices and things like that on the tablet while you're.
Sure. For right now, I'm just using a hard round 100% brush, because why not? I don't want any kind of really finicky stuff getting in the way of just what's essentially supposed to be a simple silhouette at this point.
Generally, the less complicated your tool set is, comfortable you'd be with it,
Yeah, I think there's maybe too much attention paid in general to specific kind of fancy brushes and setups and everything like that. For the most part, it's just using an efficient tool that allows you to get from one end to the other without necessarily imposing a lot of sort of complex variables on what you're doing. When you get into, like, you know, a lot of scattering and dual brushes, and then you've got, like, these weird brush shapes and stamps kind of going on, you reach a point where it's difficult to have really tight finesse over what you're doing.
Absolutely. And typically, these, like, special brushes, they're used for, like, a specific thing. Like, maybe a custom artist came up with, like, a really quick way to express, you know, like, brick or something, not, like, a brick brush.
Right.
To use it for something that's, like, not appropriate for that would be, like, a messy kind of experience, I think.
Mm-hmm.
What are your guys' thoughts on brushes? Anybody?
I think I know which, like, tool set you're using, like, that brush set. Just
yeah? Well, this is the default one they gave to us before we sat down.
Yeah, so we've actually never encountered this brush set before.
No. This is all very short.
We're just kind of guessing.
But yeah, that's, like, you can get, like, a huge brush pack, and then we'll have stuff for environments, and it's, like, incredibly specific. Like, you can't even use, like, a...
Yeah, I mean, like,
I've
created brushes to create, like, instant windows, but it's only good for windows. Like, I would never try to paint with it. Yeah.
At what point do you start to think about the background and the lighting of the scene that you're drawing?
Right now it looks like Brian's going for concept art, specifically. Yeah, and that has nothing to do with lighting or scene.
It has
nothing to do with design. Like, what you want to show with these kind of drawings is, like readability, clarification. Because ultimately, these types of drawings are going to be handed off to, like, a 3D modeler to build, so they're almost like blueprints.
Mm-hmm.
You want them to understand it as clearly as possible. However, if we're talking illustration, then that's where, like, lighting and mood and all those things start to come in. Where it's, like, a different job.
Apologize a little bit. This is a Mac keyboard I'm not really quite used to. So you may see some dialog boxes pop open over the course of this.
But Brian, when do you start thinking about mood and color?
When do I start thinking about mood and color and background? Generally for when you're working on concept art, the simpler the presentation, the better. Which is sort of the opposite of what you'd be thinking for a traditional illustration where things are a little bit fancier. It's important to remember that concept art as a portion of the process is actually just something you're using to create a roadmap for the people who come after you. There's definitely a place at larger companies for things like mood paintings and things like that, especially when you're dealing with environments and things of that nature. But for the most part, you're trying to create some sort of descriptive way of communicating with the character models who come after you what it is that they need to do. So typically, most of my lighting is just a strong three-quarters lighting, a little bit of a rim light, which is just all about all that you really need to actually describe a typical character.
Right, it's often about clarity. You want to pick the solution that would offer you the most clarity.
Mm-hmm.
You want to make it easy for the other person you're handing off to work off of.
Right, because if you can put all these really cool light effects and chromatic aberration and all that kind of jazz on it, but it's just going to get in the way of them really understanding what it is you're trying to say.
Do you guys like Battlefield? Do you guys all know Battlefield?
Yes.
Right? Do you guys all know those, like, crazy special effects you put everywhere, like with the freaking, like, camera shift and, like, the lens flares and stuff? Like, yeah, it's kind of confusing to look at, right?
Mm-hmm.
So we want to try to avoid that with concept art.
Right. Now, when you get into the illustration end, you know, you spam it or whatever, right?
Yeah.
Because then that is all about the pretty. You don't really care if things are super easy to interpret all the time. It's really just about creating something that the public is going to like and enjoy.
Right.
But
in comparison to what you're doing right now, do you often go through several silhouettes before you actually pick something in particular that you want to fully flesh out?
Yes, so typically doing a god design in Hi-Rez, I actually start with line work rather than silhouette, and I will develop quite a lot, often over the course of a day or two. So this is definitely kind of speeding up the process for me right now. But we'll go in and create a number of versions. I usually start with a set of at least 16 for a given god, and I will start with... I'll do some kind of rough silhouettes. I'll go back, I'll knock those down in opacity, trace them up with line work, do another pass with line work on top of those, and then like a final finesse pass before I even show it to anybody. So it's important to have a certain amount of internal communication, even with other artists, and you want it to be clear to a certain extent.
Often with like god designs, new gods, whoever's coming up with it, this guy, like it's a very iterative process. Like nothing you draw is probably going to stick around. someone's probably going to come over and be like, change this, change that. This is better. This is not so good. You know, it's a huge team effort is what I'm trying to say.
Yeah, I mean, for any given god, you can assume that there's going to be, you're going to put a lot of things forward. A lot of things aren't going to make it. A lot of things are going to be combined. A lot of things are going to shift around. And what the thing is finally going to be isn't necessarily where you started. So sort of the important thing when you're starting off is just to create sort of variety and interest.
Yeah.
Oh my god, not so slow. All right. So I'll go in and I'll flip the canvas back and forth periodically. And what that does for me is it lets me kind of unsee the piece.
So Brian, what are you, you know, doing right now? Are you trying to refine the silhouette here?
Silhouette isn't changing that much straight away. I'll probably do a little bit of that. I'm building in just some general kind of values, sort of figuring out where I want the masses to go. It's a little bit more contrasty on your screen than it is on mine. But I'm sort of just figuring out sort of the internal flow of this kind of thing. So
this is a very common way to start a concept. Obviously, there are many, many, many different ways, like creativity is king. We try to, you know, if you find a weird, funky way to get you a good result, then, well, let's go for it.
Yeah.
Do you have people there who specialize in the early iterative process and people who do the more polished final things, or is that just like both of those are everyone's job?
It depends. I mean, like, preferably you'd have one guy finishing everything. I mean, like, logistically, company standpoint, it's less money, right? But yeah, like, oftentimes we would pass work around just based on, like, people's schedules and ability level.
Okay.
Yes?
When you guys get an idea for a god, like, I've seen, like, how to develop a god, I've seen that video on YouTube.
Yeah.
And let's say you do, you're in the middle of designing the god, and then you come across, and when you guys figure him out, and you're like, you do all your research, but then you come across something that's a little bit more contradictory, or someone else, like, did a design that for that god that's really cool, like, will that completely, like, will you have to go back and overhaul the whole process, I guess? I guess it's going back to,
So, I mean, once things are started, they are always perpetually in change until the very end of the process. So some things are going to end up closer to where they started, but as new information comes in and people test things out and they try things, the divine develops new opinions and all that kind of stuff.
It's a huge explorative process for the entire team. Like, you get all these things out, people like get thumb people can make a judgment about them. So we build all these things for testing. And yeah. So maybe like someone would, you know, suggest a better idea, and like we'll definitely consider that moving forward. Thanks for the question.
Can you talk about the difference between trying to create a concept in an hour and actually having the, you touched on it briefly, of having the stages of doing line art and then silhouettes and having more time to actually spend on the form?
Uh-huh.
But can you talk about some of the other differences that are between speed painting in front of a live audience and having your own comfortable space to actually do what you're
doing? That's a very, very good question. Typically, we don't speed paint as concept artists because that doesn't really get our job done. Yeah. Our job is to, like, explain design to our superiors and to basically get design out. Speed painting is just, like, we're just trying to finish something as quickly as possible without really thinking about design, unless you are right.
Sort of. You tell me, does it look like I'm thinking about design?
Maybe.
I don't know.
I mean, like, when I'm at work doing my job, I was talking like a rough drawing that gets, like, I'll say this word a lot, design out as quickly as possible. And that might not include, like, splotching paint on the canvas. That might include a very, like, tight line work. But, like, whatever I would need to communicate that.
Yeah, so it's kind of all over the place. For the most part, at least on the character team, there's definitely a final render pass that's a lot more complicated, and that will take days to complete.
Yeah.
And prior to that, like I said, I usually start with line work. So there's not a whole bunch of, like, direct speed painting that comes up. But speed painting is still definitely a useful way to sort of hone your skills and think about value.
Yeah,
and
I mean,
speed
painting is, like,
stuff.
A really good practice for getting, you know, it forces you to confront every part of the painting pretty quickly.
Yeah. So, like, all this
going.
Is, All of this is really happening over the course of some other process, but with more sort of steps and control to actually sort of keep it together.
I've always wondered, as a concept artist, how, when you go into work, like at the beginning of the day, do you have a new thing that people are telling you to do, or do you have, like, one assignment for the week that's carrying over just until it's done? Like, what are the deadlines like, and what are your missions?
It really depends on what's needed for the game.
Yeah.
But every day is going to be different.
Yeah, that's for sure. I mean, some projects will take minutes or hours, and some projects will take weeks.
Or months,
yeah. And it just depends, sometimes on the complexity, sometimes on, you know, various political factors, all that kind of jazz. And sometimes you got no luck. And those things go on for a while.
Does that answer your question, sort of?
Yeah, I mean, I can see it's so varied that it's like coming up with an answer would probably be very difficult.
Yeah, I mean, I guess if you guys are able to go into like a studio job similar to this, like just arm yourself with, be well versed in techniques, just be able to pull out any trick you need to get any given job done. And then, like, I guess that's sort of ideal, right?
Yeah, I would agree. I mean, a lot of variability is just sort of essential for it. Because there's going to be cases where you're going to have all the time in the world and you need to deliver a highly finished product, and cases where you have no time, and you just have to roll with it.
I mean, maybe you're really good at drawing girls, but like not so good at drawing space marines.
Yeah, I mean, there may be some game out there where you draw a lot of space marines, but that's not really a good plan for when Space Marine Company goes under. And you gotta go to Pretty Girl Company.
Yeah.
They're like, no, son, we don't want your Space Marines.
Yeah,
we want Pretty Girls now. They're gonna be like, I can't draw those. And then you'll be sad. Yeah.
And Detro sucks.
Oh, it sucks.
When designing a character, do you ever have those moments that you kind of stop, look at it, and imagine how it's going to move and decide, I don't like that, and then restart? And
every single time I try to do something.
Yeah,
I guess while we're doing these, like the biggest question we want to answer is like how it's going to work in the game, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like if it moves, is it going to like flip through stuff? Is it going to look really wacky?
Yeah.
It's going to look cool. They're always trying to make it look cool.
A lot of it, beyond just the practical, does it look cool sitting on the page? You got to kind of run through all the different steps that happen in game art after you, and what's gonna work, and what is not gonna work, and what may work, but everyone will murder you for it. Oh my god, where did it go?
You painted a layer over top of it.
Okay, there we go. Terror!
I guess like a pretty general rule of thumb to keep in mind when you're continuing concept work is like function over form. You always want to think about the functionality of the concept before you start like dressing it up, I suppose.
Mm-hmm.
You want to make sure that it works first.
Yeah,
just logistically.
Which is a big difference between, again, concept art and illustration, and like fine art or something like that. Ultimately, you're trying to make something that's going to go well in the game. I'm zooming it out. Zooming out, you know, can kind of tell you what's working or what's not.
How much does it take to adjust when you're saying, for example, in your case, you were working at, for New Legends, we're working at, that's how you have to change the art style, Smite, what does that...
It was actually like a very natural shift, because I think Smite, or like, at least the team at Smite, it's a very similar aesthetic.
Mm.
Yeah. So in that regard, it wasn't that big of a shift. Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know. I came from, Zynga Dallas prior to this?
Yeah.
That was a bit of a shift. they don't do this.
Oh,
I guess not. Well, they don't do anything anymore. They yeah, they cease to exist. This guy's, on the street right now. It's very sad.
That red light.
Rim lights are nice. Yeah.
Out of curiosity, what was your favorite god that you designed?
My favorite god that I designed, I'm a big fan of Bologna, actually.
She's
pretty recent, but
likes Bologna.
She is really fun to play. I like her a lot.
Thanks. I am not responsible for that part, but...
but in terms of design, I love her armor design.
Thank you. Yeah, that was a good project. I think a lot of things came together well on that one.
It does seem like there's a trend from what I've seen in the recent designs that it's more practical armor compared to some of the older designs, which were a bit more fan-based and building up.
Yeah, I mean, that's been partly sort of just as Smite has developed. We've noticed some things work really well and some things don't necessarily all the time. And it's just sort of transitioned to be a little bit more sort of put together and rational in that sense. There was a time in Smite history where things were a little bit just more like whatever kind of looks good, but now there's a little bit more kind of practicality sort of instilled into it. It does a better job, I think, of sort of character storytelling and putting them together if you know what each piece is sort of there for. Just as a concept artist, that tends to be more satisfying as a player, easier to understand and interact with. So...
I think Riot went through a very similar phase, where like in the beginning of the product, everything was just kind of all over the place. But then once it started getting more successful, they had the time to like, go back into it, you know, things are designed with purpose.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Are we all gamers here? We all like to play games?
Yes.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Good.
What's everyone's favorite game?
Metal Gear Solid.
Metal Gear Solid! It's looking pretty awesome.
Yes. Right now, Ori and the Blind Forest.
It's beautiful.
Oh, yeah, it's gorgeous.
Yeah,
talk about that at lunch.
I loved it. Game of the Year 2015, no hands down.
Absolutely, man.
Unless Star Fox Wii U pulls something amazing.
Yeah.
When I was last playing console games, I don't know, right now, in terms of console exclusives, I'm playing Killer Instinct.
Yeah.
I like that game a lot.
Nice.
But before that, I freaking love Dragon's Dogma.
Yeah.
It was like Shadow of the Colossus meets Skyrim.
Just all the...
It's beautiful.
All the good things combined.
Yeah. Pretty much all the things I like.
Yeah.
Mass Effect 2 is still sort of at the top of my game pyramid.
Mass Effect 2 is a bit of a classic, isn't it?
Yeah.
How's Dragon Age?
Yeah, Dragon Age is good too, but not on the consoles. You really need to get that one on the PC.
Yeah.
Will you sometimes ask people from other departments, like, if they could see the design really working out? Like, let's say, for some reason, like, you decide to move along with this guy, or the project, for some reason, moves along with this. Then someone from the animation team says, that needs to be fixed, we cannot work with that.
That's an interesting question.
Yes,
because
constantly, always.
All the time, yeah. Like, I sit in the hallways, and everyone sees, like, everything I do, and they all have something to say about it.
Yeah. Definitely on the character team, there's a lot of internal meetings to kind of decide on the design, and those are immediately followed up by a leads meeting. And the leads meeting will contain all of the major players from all the various disciplines. So the animators, the programmers, everybody. We'll get together and talk about sort of the practical ramifications of whatever you've put together and whether it's something that's going to work.
Or some demon just walked by and be like, that sucks.
Yeah, but that guy can just F right off, can't he?
Except my entertainers are buttons anyway.
Could you two tell us a little bit about how you got started, some of your first jobs, or how you got to Hi-Rez?
Brian? Sure. So, sort of a long, winding road on that bit. I started off, when I was two, I knew I wanted to be a concept artist, even though I didn't know what that was. But I went to school, undergrad, studied illustration at University of Kansas. Double majored in graphic design. Did not have the skills to actually be competitive in the industry yet when I got out of undergrad. So I worked in advertising for a couple of years, doing a little bit of illustration on the side. Ended up going back to grad school at the Guildhall at SMU. Interned at Zynga Dallas for a while. Transitioned into Hi-Rez as a hard surface artist, making guns for tribes. Part of my responsibility when I was making my guns was to figure out what the guns would look like. And they ultimately decided that they liked me better for figuring out what things would look like than for actually making guns. So, here I am, a concept artist.
There you go.
Yeah.
That's Brian's journey. Everyone has unique journeys. I mean,
how about you?
I don't think it's the best to like compare with other people. They probably have a really nice story. My own story is very different. I started off freelancing, actually. So I was working like paycheck to paycheck. I was traveling a lot during that time. So I was sort of like this like wandering artist character, just like penny from my penny tickets for like my contract. Until eventually they reached out to me, I rested, and I joined. So there I am full time now. But when I was like, but when I first graduated, like, finding a full time gig anywhere was really hard. Was it like that for you as well?
From grad school, no, not really.
No.
No, I had a few offers.
That's cool.
Yeah, I was well positioned.
It just depends on like whether you're a good student or not.
Yeah, I did all right, but it's definitely, you got to go through the pain kind of one way or another. Because I did the whole, you know, I did the advertising bit, I did the whole freelancing bit before any of that got started. So this is just kind of how it goes.
Thank you.
Boy, this is weird to do. Other questions, anybody?
How informed are the color choices are you making? Are you just sort of like pulling up the colors and picking whichever one looks okay, or is there?
I have a general sense of kind of where I want things to be based on, you know, like other knowledge of anatomy and that kind of stuff. It's a little bit, you know, a little bit rough because I'm just kind of guessing at it, but generally kind of the slightly more slimy pink skin color and a little bit more of the brown for the fur. Sort of keeping it a little bit more naturalistic in general.
Do you have any books that you have on your desk, like that you look at when you run into trouble?
I have a lot of art books that I share with my coworkers.
Yeah, I don't know. I use a lot of just honestly Google and online resources like that. I definitely have a selection of anatomy books and stuff that I use that definitely come more in handy for people than stuff like this. But Pinterest is actually just a great thing for an artist. Actually, there's a tremendous amount of resources up there. Yeah, and that'll make your life easier. But
should we talk about this creature a little bit?
Sure.
What are we drawing here?
Some sort of monster thing, kind of furry, sort of insectile, a little bit whatever's going on here.
What's his name?
What is he? His name is Hubert.
Hubert.
It's a total coincidence. It actually means the gut destroyer in the language of Xanathar.
What's his favorite meal?
Guts.
Guts.
Of course. It makes sense.
Of course.
Yeah. His favorite color is blue.
Which is weird because he's colorblind. His tiny black eyes do not understand.
He's totally unaware that he's not blue at all.
Yeah, he actually thinks everything is blue, so his life is actually really good. But he's just he's actually a really agreeable kind of guy when you get to know him.
How does he eat guts, though? He doesn't have any teeth.
Oh, no, he's got teeth. You just can't see them yet.
Okay.
The teeth are happening. you gotta just let the teeth happen.
Yeah, we'll just paint some happy teeth.
Yeah.
Is
he the family?
We gotta get the jaw in there,
you
know?
Does he
know how
pictures taken of him?
What's he trying to
say? He's kind of bashful, actually.
Yeah.
Like, he was always, like, as a kid, he was just like, he didn't want to... Just didn't want to be seen.
It's kind of a legendary Pokemon.
Yeah, he was, he's a chubby kid in high school. He's just all awkward about it.
Well... Yeah, he shut those down.
Oh, he did. I mean, it actually turns out that that gut-destroying really sheds the coward.
So when you're detailing his face like that, like, what do you think about as you're doing this?
At the moment, I'm looking at the fact that I don't have enough value range for me to really describe a lot of the things. So I'm going back through and I'm sort of installing some more darks and that kind of thing. And then just looking to sort of firm up some of the edges that aren't necessarily reading super clear. But just generally trying to keep a sort of more slimy and kind of little carapace-y kind of look thing going on here. So, yeah.
What do you do when you finish a design and you feel the design looked better rough than finished?
Cry.
Well, you hand it off anyway and hope that it goes well.
Yeah, sometimes you just show it to your art director and he's just, I love this
yeah,
as much as the original one.
He's like, I love it, let's put it in. Sure.
Yeah, another time he's just like, no, what? What's wrong with you?
Yeah.
And then you try and problem solve. If you go to other people and they're just like, I kind of lost it or whatever, people are full of advice. They're so full of advice. All of them for that.
The thing about being a concept artist is that, like, everybody has someone to say about everything, so if you need some input, just go to anybody.
Mm-hmm.
Like, hey, I'm doing this game, God, damn this say, they probably do.
Yes. So it's critique is just a big part of the culture, going back and forth and talking to people and finding out ways to do things better. And even when you think that you've done something really well, making sure that you've actually done something really well, you gotta go back and check with people and make sure your peers agree and understand. Otherwise, you go back to it and you tweak things again. It's all part of the, character never really being done.
Yeah, you don't want to go backwards.
Mm-hmm. Which you'll do from time to time. Just sort of inevitably. But it's good to just keep things rolling when all possible.
If you're doing one of your initial 16 workups that you were talking about earlier,
mm-hmm.
would you put this much detail into them?
How long have I been doing this?
I don't know, man.
I certainly don't know. Now, typically, all I'm looking to do with those is create a very kind of concrete description of a few things. I would spend less time finessing little details of what I'm doing right now and more time on specific design parameters, like, what does the shaft of this hammer look like? What does the shoulder pad look like? Et cetera, et cetera. And my goal typically with a round of 16 is to have 16 very unique individual things that work put together on the page. And then they can just push and pull and combine and make it make sense. That is so saturated up there. Okay. For you guys, I'm just going to lower that.
That's
better. Looks like nothing down here now. That's okay.
Let me ask you guys a question. As students, when you guys are doing this kind of like maybe this kind of work, like what's going through your heads as you're approaching design and concept art?
Man, I need to finish this tonight.
Okay, so it's the same thing that's going through our heads.
Yeah.
This looks awful. I'm gonna start over.
Well,
how would I make this move?
Man, I suck at character design.
Well, let me ask you a question there, then. What makes a good character design versus, like, a bad one?
Huh?
how long is it readable? Does it show emotion? Is it readable with the audience? Or
yeah.
I'm always told with being in animation that my character, well, human characters, they all start looking the same.
Right.
They're all, what I've heard is they're too perfectly proportioned.
Oh, then exaggerate.
Stop doing that.
Exaggerate. Look around this room. Like you can see people all like all different body types. Like,
yeah, it's sort of important to just always sort of push your boundaries. And do things you're not always like immediately sort of comfortable with. That's part of the reason for doing like the large scale iterative process and going through and making a bunch of varieties.
Yeah.
Because probably your first impulse is also your safest impulse. You just want to kind of get outside of that.
Yeah, I mean, especially just like look at people. You'll find that people all look crazy different. Like Gabe's really muscular in the back. Just like skinny.
Yeah.
Telling the truth.
So I guess I got a question. So when you approach armor design, and you want to do like a lot of decals or some minute details on the armor to make it look like it's ornate or like there's carvings and etchings all over it, what kind of resources you usually use as a reference for that?
Yeah. So for Smite, even though the essential like the large-scale language, the proportions of the character and everything like that are taken from more traditional video game sources, I actually spend a lot of time actually pulling from actual archaeological records for the Greeble. So somewhere in there is a piece of, like, Roman antique pottery or something like that that gave the little swirly bit that goes on the left shoulder.
I tend to always look at real stuff, because then, like, if you look at video game information, that's kind of, like, distilled first-hand information, you know? It's like third-hand information, maybe. You can look at, like, a real piece of armor, you're trying to design something that's, like, world-crafty, maybe, but it has to look like a nice armor. Then look at a nice armor. It's got all that information there for you to reference.
Right.
It's just, like, rich, you know? Mm-hmm. Whereas, like, if you look at, like, a Warcraft armor set, you know, it's kind of, like, simplified down. It's not very comprehensive of what you're trying to study.
If you're trying to do, like, multi-layered armor, I'm sure as a concept artist, you don't probably have to figure out how it all moves and works yet, but, I don't know, is that part of the process?
Research?
Well, not just research, but...
Yes, that is the process.
Yeah, there's an extensive amount of research that goes into moving armor, because, like, knight armor is very complex and complicated.
Right, and there's always going to be sort of, it tends to be a back and forth between sort of animation, rigging, and the modelers. Modelers like to have lots of really complex stuff going on because it's fun for them to make.
Mm-hmm.
Animators don't want that crap because it doesn't actually add to the emotion of the character and everything, and they have to sit around making the dumb cloth bend every time somebody steps in one direction or another. So there's sort of there's a little bit of a back and forth considering like what is the appropriate amount and what isn't, and what amount of sort of fakeness and just video gaminess can go into any given design versus what is totally practical and sensible. I think as games are maturing, designs are getting more and more practically thought out over time, so you no longer have the floating shoulder pad. It's something that is actually attached to the arm with straps or something else, or yeah. There's something that makes it feel better, and you can tell sort of just looking at things whether they feel sort of credible based on that.
Yeah.
That's a big deal to players in percent.
What are some of the most common blending modes you use when you're painting?
So I'm using a completely different set of layer modes for you guys right now, given the speed that I'm working out and everything that I typically do at work. I actually have a set of group layers that I use that essentially emulate the way that the Unreal 3 engine processes lighting for a given character. So it's a combination of linear dodge, multiply, and then a couple of other procedural things like gradients and things like that. But yeah, it's convenient because I can essentially step back and forth, and if I feel like it, I can go ahead and just put the dude in a dang forest without having to actually go back and repaint it.
You gotta get me in on that.
I try and get everybody in on that, but then they actually look at my layers and they hyperventilate and pass off. It's really convenient, but it's really scary. But yeah, there's actually, I've spent a fair amount of time studying just light physics, and the interaction between surfaces and specular and like Fresnels and all that kind of shit, and how that comes together. So that's sort of invalidated a lot of things that I used to use. This is me sort of working a little bit old school tonight for the sake of what we're doing.
So you usually don't worry about the different, like there's lighting that makes different colors off of, that bounces off of you and stuff like that. You don't usually worry about that?
That's automatically calculated by my system.
Oh.
That's actually one of the things that it does. So if I want to switch out the rim light or the ambient light or the key light, et cetera, et cetera, essentially I've already got it mathematically calculating out for what the sum of that is.
So
that's awesome. Maybe
something will start to figure out. Essentially you're just combining the tech guy's job with... Is that happening a bit?
A little bit. I mean, yeah. This originally just started with me. This sort of fundamental question right here of just like, painting this blue kind of light on top here and feeling that it didn't read as credibly as I wanted it to. This is sort of back in grad school or whatever. I knew from working as a hard surfaced artist and doing my own materials in Unreal. Sort of the general way in which materials were processed, sort of diffuse with an additive specular. What I found out really quickly is that the math for the equation is actually not particularly complicated on like a per pixel basis, and that Photoshop essentially just being a large 2D vector math program could emulate most of that just using these simple layer modes that we know. After that it was mostly just stumbling through and trying different things until I reached one that accommodated most of my needs without being too complicated.
Not too complicated, you make people hyperventilate.
I'm not going to. I'm working on it. Yeah, no, I'm exaggerating a little bit with the hyperventilation thing, but it's a little bit kind of, I think, formal and mathematical for a lot of artists who would tend to prefer working in a little bit more of a free-form way.
Well, math is fun.
I like math. I took calculus for no reason. Yeah.
Yes?
Have you ever made it along so far with a design and then you find and then someone looks over your shoulder and goes, hey, that looks like this and
well,
then
dude, that totally happened to me like yesterday.
Yeah, I was saying this is almost always a penis. That's almost always what the end of that sentence is. if you can't help it, I mean they're swinging swords around all day. Yeah, it's that, yeah. And then you may go back or whatever, or you may cry. But far better it happens to you than it happens to the character modeler after, like, 4 weeks of actually building the dumb thing.
Then people will be really mad at you, and you don't want that.
Yeah, it's just like...
at least when they catch it early, it's funny. Like, I was seeing this one drawing, people walked up and they're like, is that, like, a clown's face or something? I'm like, no. Clown face? And I took a step back and I saw it. But then luckily by then, you can, like, easily change it.
Yeah.
Without having anything built. Shipped.
Was that an icon?
Yeah.
The clown face icon.
Dude, people were making a big deal.
Were they really?
Yeah.
Alright.
I had to walk out. I had to break out of this.
I can't deal with this right now. Made a clown face, y'all can deal with it.
New Bologna skin. Clown face Bologna.
Clown face Bologna. I will get right on that. I don't know what's our time box for any of this kind of stuff. Did you want to switch off at any point? We did that earlier.
Well, whenever you feel like switching, I guess.
Okay. If you're still up for it, I know originally you just wanted to talk the whole time.
No, let's just wing it.
Okay, cool.
Winging it.
Let's keep winging it. Change places.
That's what you got.
Yeah, so saturated. All right.
You want to talk about stuff?
Yeah, I can talk about stuff. Wants to ask questions.
So just...
Nobody. This is good. This is easy. Gabe! What's up, Gabe?
Hey! How's it going, Gabe? Was there any part of when you did the concept for Medusa and you handed it off to the next team, did they have any... Was there any, like, issue with anything that you had concepted for? Like, was there anything specifically like, I don't think this will work, or was it all pretty smooth?
For Medusa, I mean, there's always a little bit of back and forth, even in the early kind of concept phase about things. She was honestly one of the less contentious ones, honestly. There was sort of an original discussion that came up that was probably the biggest thing back and forth, was sort of more of a culturally appropriate depiction of Medusa, sort of an ancient Greek version, or sort of the more popular sort of Clash of the Titans style. It's like the Greek original was essentially, she had the hideous face, she had the snakes, but her body was that of a woman, and she was occasionally depicted as having wings. And that would be the more traditional sort of Greek personification of Medusa. Clash of the Titans came out a few decades ago, and they depicted her as having the snake body and as being an archer, which has become sort of the more expected way. Oh my god, what happened?
Relax.
Are they making luck? I don't know how they do that. but sort of which way to go. I think as frequently happens when concept...
Like, I'm trying to find shortcuts here. Sometimes they don't work.
Yeah, that's a real quick thing. Just fill the silhouette, flip it, and stretch the thing around.
That's one way to, like, do a quick shadow.
Yeah.
It's perspective, but it's not working here. This perspective is, like, top down three quarters.
Yeah, it only works in certain limited capacities.
Yeah. But it's, like, a nice little cheat if you're out of time. You need, like, a little, like, crowd shadow.
Yeah.
Well, there's the perspective tool.
Oh, no. I mean, like, it only works if you don't have to, like, make perspective. Like, I'm literally just copying it and flipping it. And it only works if it's like a full-on shot, like...
Yeah, well, I mean, flipping it upside down, you shouldn't have to do that for this one.
Yeah.
I have to let it to the first three quarters. What was that? Yeah, obviously, like, Clash of the Titans won out. But, And he's just going through and playing with values and stuff right now. It's blending shit.
Like, when I was looking at it from the screen,
it looks really harsh.
Really harsh.
Down there, I don't know. It didn't bug me as much.
Actually, yeah. When I look at this, it doesn't look as harsh.
Yeah, that seems
shocking.
A little bit. It's a little bit garish up there.
It's raining.
Yeah.
The whole time.
You guys have that kind of problem, like when you're presenting stuff too. Like, oh wow, this looks great on my computer, but it looks awful over here.
Yeah, I mean, every computer is a little bit different. You try and standardize them a little bit, but especially if you get into a meeting room or something and you got like a big TV to show everything on, and that's just operating in dumb TV space when it doesn't understand anything that's happening. So you gotta go in and fix that jazz. But.
Oh, how about talk about your, what's like your day-to-day like, Brian?
What's my day-to-day like?
Yes.
That's an interesting and complicated question with so many pieces.
Oh, man. Sorry.
No, that's fine. So, I think we talked about it earlier. We got a number of different projects that happen at a number of different speeds. God design is the most complex. That takes the longest. It involves the most number of iterations, the most feedback from leads, the most total number of changes over the course of something happening. And that can be a few weeks to, you know, even longer of just total time spent getting everybody in on the same page. And that will happen sort of with breaks in between. You'll complete a few things, and then there'll have to be time for the leads to convene and all that kind of jazz. Talk about it, test some things, and then go back and reiterate and correct. There's also skin design, which is a little bit easier. Usually a lot of that is working off of established skins and rigs and everything, so there's not as much opportunity to actually sort of mess things up and be confusing. So that's more like mild aesthetic concerns and things of that nature. And that will be quicker. Like a really complex skin, you know, that may take a few days to put together. Really brief ones, just like put a t-shirt and a ball cap on this guy, is done in like no time. What?
Yeah, that does happen quite a bit.
Yeah, exactly. So, and a lot of them will kind of pile up on each other. They sort of just dogpile you all the time with different sort of input coming in from different sides. You got to kind of manage it. I'm usually sort of stacked a few concepts deep at any given moment and just kind of going back as one of them is handed off to whoever and just waiting for it to cycle back through again. And then, you know, occasionally you'll have more complex kind of skin deals. Anytime Bologna is involved because of her multiple stances, that becomes more complex. Thanatos, Mighty Morphin Thanatos, the angelic version, that guy was complicated just because of the nature, the technical requirements of actually getting them all together and making that sort of happen. So that was a much longer skin. I provide a lot of critique for like 2D card artists and things like that. So any of the loading cards that you see in our game, I'll consult with the art director to sort of critique those. I will help critique the other concept artists. I will interact with the character artists, see how they're going. If they have any questions, I may provide support drawings in addition to the original concepts that I made. We have weekly meetings where we go over just everything that we've done and decide with those guys, based on their feedback, go back and iterate. I will make cards myself on occasion when the time calls for it. And then, yeah. A lot of stuff.
That sounds like a pretty rich day-to-day.
It's all over the place, yeah.
Yeah. But more interestingly, like, what do you guys expect when you guys are, you know, done with school, you guys have entered a studio? What do you guys expect out of, like, a game studio experience?
Get a lot of work done.
Okay. Well, that's true. It's a reasonable expectation.
But a lot more fun with it, I guess you could say.
I mean, if it helps, like, I love my job. It's like,
yeah, exactly.
It's like awesome every day I walk in. Mm-hmm. Yeah, like, I love the people I work with. Typically, like, a lot of like-minded people.
Yeah. Having to, when I say this, either, I would say it would be hard to correspond with the art style that the person would want.
Yeah, I mean, it's definitely,
I guess really worried about art styles.
Yeah, I mean, you're not going to be, unless you're in the position of being in pre-production on a project, working, like, directly with the art director in sort of, like, a lead kind of concept capacity or something like that, you're not going to be determining the broad art style of how things come together. You're going to be working within it. And on many cases, on games that have, like, previous IPs or anything like that, it's not going to differ too much from what already existed. So a lot of that is just coming down to your sort of ability to adapt to conditions on the ground and mimic what's already there.
Yeah.
And that just comes down to strong fundamentals, observational skills, and an ability to take critique.
Unless you're
working
on a totally new project.
Yeah, and then there's going to be just a lot of back and forth to figure out what that new project kind of is.
Yeah, a lot of it would just be, like, exactly, like, figure out what it's even.
Yeah. Like, new art style, that's always that's a bit of a trip, a bit of a challenge. So, but yeah, everybody, when you're actually working on a project, you'll kind of fall into the same style. And a lot of effort will actually be spent kind of policing that style and making sure it fits together.
Did you have to do, like, an art test before you started working at Hi-Rez?
I did.
Yeah, me too.
Did you?
Yeah, I don't know what yours was like.
I was doing one for Coleman.
For Coleman?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah?
And then I got, like, a totally different project.
Yeah, I was going to say.
Yeah.
I did. I mean, it was sort of a little bit of a combination of concept and modeling-oriented back in the day. We were a much smaller studio a few years ago when I started. We've over doubled in size since then. But I was wearing a few hats at the time. So, but it's pretty standard. The art test I got at Hi-Rez was pretty reasonable.
Uh-huh.
It didn't take that long. You hear about other companies, you know, you may have a 2-week art test, or I've heard of one that lasts 3 months.
Oh, man.
And no.
Impressive.
So.
Is that paid?
No, it's an art test.
Art tests are, I mean, like, I don't know, I guess they're not.
Yeah, I mean.
But that's just the way it is.
Yeah, that's just the way it is. I would think carefully before petitioning for something like that. You could tell in that case they're definitely trying to see, you know, how bad did they want it, more so than, you know, what is the skill level.
Yeah.
So.
Typically, I guess our tests are given out when, like, it's clear that the person has the skill set, but they're not sure if they can match the style.
Well,
I just really want to see if they can match the style, right?
I think that's a big part of it, yeah. Or, you know, it's more common for people who don't have a long history, is
essentially
what it comes down to. So, as a student, almost guarantee it. Anywhere you're going to look, you get an art test.
An art test.
Probably be free. Yeah, so, yeah. And when you get to be somebody who's more senior and established, if they can look down your list of titles and they can see your portfolio, you probably won't have to do it unless it's you're trying to stretch yourself and do something a little bit different in the industry than you've done before.
Yeah.
So.
Oh, just so you guys know, we should probably wrap up Herbert in like 15 minutes.
Okay.
No problem.
So if you guys have questions, we'll try to finish in 15 minutes.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
What would you say would be like maybe the number one or maybe top three things that you should worry about in your portfolio or your samples to try to, I guess, tell a company that you can do?
If you're going to apply anywhere, you want to have characters, vehicles, props, environments. Hit those three. Send it. If you're going to shoot for, like, Hi-Rez, you know, like, shoot for that style. If you're going to shoot for, like, Infinity Ward, go for realistic, you know.
Yeah.
Try to match with, like, whatever company you're in. Like, cater your portfolio to whatever company you plan to apply for.
But don't zero in so hard on one style.
That is going to
lock yourself into only one company.
It's a very delicate balance of like what you want and what can be reality, I guess.
Yeah, it's good to plan to demonstrate that what you're doing shows competence to work within a range of styles, essentially. If not all styles, but like I can do hardcore realism and slightly less realism or whatever. You're going to catch, you know, more people than if you just go with only hardcore realism or, you know, cartoony to a little bit less cartoony kind of deal.
Right.
The typical wisdom goes that you're only as good as your worst piece.
Yeah, keep that in mind. That's pretty important.
Yeah, so, like, if you've got something that's kind of on the ball, you don't know what the quality, if it's up to quality or not, don't put that piece in your portfolio, because people are going to assume that is the most typical kind of work that you're going to turn in.
Like, I've looked at portfolios that open with, like, a really nice piece, and you scroll down, you look at something that's, like, as if they were done by, like, someone totally different, and you're like, what the hell just happened, you know?
Yeah,
it's even
exactly.
The same person.
So, just keep that consistent level of quality. If you're not certain, toss it. So
that would be...
Your portfolio doesn't have to be massive. You only need a certain number of pieces, I would say. But they all need to be good. And just demonstrate a certain level of polish and finesse.
Yes.
Who comes up with the ideas for skins? Do you ever accept fan suggestions?
Sometimes. Yeah. There's actually R. Smite skin concepts. I can tell you I was browsing it earlier today. we absolutely have accepted skin suggestions from fans before, and it's been the origins of some things that kind of came from there. Poolside and got its beginnings on Reddit. We look at that stuff. Mind you, a lot of it doesn't work because of various technical considerations, and a lot of it is just like,
What are you people smoking?
But we look at it all.
Do you select something, then do you give credit to who possibly came up with the design?
Usually if it's in the few cases that we've looked at this, like Poolside or whatever, there were a number of people who said about the same thing at the same time. So that's typically how that goes. But yeah, I don't know. I mean, skin concepts can originate from almost anywhere. Really? So anybody at the company has a right to suggest it and can swing by and just talk to anybody, submit it to a document, anything like that. And we'll look at it.
Rough.
Huh?
It's still, like, super rough on that screen.
Yeah, no, it doesn't get less rough on that screen.
Wow, is that, like, even possible?
I don't know. It's magic, man.
Well, how does it look like? Oh, wow, too rough.
Yeah,
Do you keep designs that didn't make the cut?
I keep all of the designs
in my drawer. Where I can reminisce and be like, this could have been so good if I made it in.
Yeah,
but
no. we have Perforce, which is essentially just like, it's where you put all of the files. And that's where all of the everything goes. So as long as it got sketched out in the first place, it exists somewhere with a specific name so I can find it again. You go back and you find it. Eventually, you know, maybe it'll be necessary sometime in the future.
Yeah, I mean, like, everything can be used. It's not like
Yeah, I mean, the wrong fit for now isn't necessarily the wrong fit for forever.
Exactly.
What is this?
Tool. It's just a tool that makes things nice.
It's
a
tool that
makes things nice.
I've never used this burn tool.
You need to use the burn tool.
It's like
dude,
said
the burn
tool is like,
great.
Any tool
what?
I need to use
yeah.
to get the results I need.
Nobody knows about the burn tool.
Whatever. Dudes, like, we don't even need to use the dodge tool. We could even use the every other tool that does kind of a similar thing.
Yeah. There's a billion and one solutions for every problem. Play around with dodge and burn. Do some cool things.
You want to be the guy with like a lot of different solutions. You don't want to be like that one trick Tony that can only do this one way. Yeah, that's pretty easy to get, you know, turns out.
Yeah.
From boredom.
Well, there's always going to be that situation where you need just the right tool.
Tendril.
I know, right?
In the best way.
They signify. It's just
how many
ghosts
he has
ripped
out?
All else fails, add spikes.
Yeah.
Always works.
This is how we do things at Blizzard. Like, bigger is better, spike chains and skulls, on all the things.
And lots of red and black?
Sort of.
That doesn't hurt.
Sorry.
That's how we're doing it.
Oh,
I suppose you're right. It's very translucent. Like subsurface. You can even be like a drone.
It's an angler fish now.
The fish will never see this coming. I'm just a worm, you guys! Try to eat me, please!
But then, like, this asshole comes along and he takes a bite out of your face and you're like, what the hell just happened?
He got kids devoured.
He did have a clam over his back.
This is his skin he's going to be getting.
Just imagining a species like that. Where, like, there's actually an indigenous life that looks like that, that they eat as part of our own diet.
Do I have an indigenous this?
A terrifying species.
Honestly, when I go to work, whatever method I use, it's just whatever I use.
I imagine a species like that would be a part of it. If you turn that chat to Nate, and think
it's like,
those words
were
kind of like, they're like, oh, he looks just like you.
I know.
That's
right.
Oh,
well,
that,
there's
that
another green light you can't see.
I guess.
Yeah. I mean,
he's just got one dangling.
Yeah, I think we've got a spring out.
Yeah, no, the whole backside is covered in green light. You can't see it. Yeah, it's just over the other side. The other side.
What else do you need, man? I guess
you need
more spike chains and skulls. I think he's somebody's pet. He's like a collar or something.
Okay. Yeah. Hubert.
Make it red.
Okay, well, don't worry. What's happening?
Yes.
For anyone who plays League, it's kind of like Malzahar's...
Oh, yeah!
Void creature.
Out of curiosity, you said you did designs for League and Warcraft. What other ones did you do for those?
You mean, like, for those games?
Yeah, just out of curiosity.
I worked on a lot of different heroes, like Tryndamere, Anivia...
Sweet.
Ravis. Dude, the list goes on. I don't know. But, yeah, like, I also did, like a Wukong skin. That might have been, like, the last thing I did for League.
Which one?
Shadow Isle. Or Spectral Wukong is what they called it. You like that one?
That was awesome.
Oh my god, we changed it so much. But thank you.
So They just released that, though.
Did they? I mean, those were done, like, last year, actually. They
were
done quite a while ago.
Yeah, last Halloween.
Yeah.
That's really? That just came out? Are you serious? That's really funny.
Yeah, I wanted to get it.
How long does it take for you to do a concept of
Have a schedule?
At least at Hi-Rez.
Oh, at Hi-Rez is pretty quick compared to like Riot. At Riot, we spend months and stuff.
But it's
serious.
$5.
I remember earlier when
you guys
had to go like that. Did you need a cane and top hat to go with that?
Totally, man.
He also needs a...
He has to go to work, okay? He's playing.
You need to get off alone. You gotta make
it work.
Literally aging as time goes on.
I'm like
orders original in his pocket or something like that.
I guess, you know,
you
need
like a
bathrobe. I think
you
need some sort of hat.
It needs a mustache.
Oh, no. Cat spikes.
Cat spikes? What?
That's not gonna stay on.
No, but he's very like passionful.
The dapper mustache. It's gotta have the company mustache.
He's a pimp what? Is that okay? What's a pimp cup?
I think it's just like a...
It's a grail.
Chalice.
It's a grail, okay.
Okay, so it's like some sort of chalice that'll go right here, I guess. I'm such a professional.
Why not a pressure for you?
Yeah.
Somebody mentioned, I believe it was, he mentioned Medusa, and you said, I remember her. Was that a joke, or had you done it a long time ago?
Yes and yes. Medusa was actually the version of the concept. We had a few tweaks recently, but has been sitting around for, what, year and a half or whatever before we got back on her. So sometimes things happen quickly, sometimes they don't. So, yep.
Yep. You want to add on to this, like, Hipposaurus?
What do we even add to this Hipposaurus?
What does he need, people?
Mustache.
Money!
Mustache. There shall be a mustache.
Just drive it. Yes! Yes!
Not the hardest one.
Why didn't you become Waluigi?
You just do whatever the hell you feel like all day long. The crowd tells you.
That's not how it is.
How do you need the light on the scotch?
He needs oh, he does.
Get the shell. It definitely has a hat.
I have the light on the hat. Don't spoil this.
All right. That's pretty lit.
The rim on the top of the hat needs a little bit.
I'm supposed to want to lit. How lit is this?
I'm gonna give it a 7.
That's
you
average.
Put a giant-ass diamond ring on like the back leg.
Oh.
Alright, he has like a little like mini me thumb coming out here. And he gets like a little ring. Like a diamond on it.
He probably use a cigar somewhere.
Your function has to be made sway.
I don't really want to stop you, but...
I could stop it as long as you
This is quickly going to degrade if you don't.
You gotta save this.
You guys have done a great job. Recording some videos, you can rewatch it and
Live
with all your questions.
So,
if you'll let me have that, that'd be awesome.
Is this
thank you guys for coming.